So on Sunday, on Sunday morning Bible study, when I was filling in for Rick, we actually got a little bit further in this class. So we're actually picking up in Psalms chapter 5. Psalms chapter 5. And we're just getting ready to dive into verses 4 to 6. So if you'd like to open up your Bibles and follow along, we'll be starting off in Psalms chapter 5. So Psalms chapter 5, starting in verse 4, it reads, "For you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness. No evil can dwell with you. The boastful will not stand before your eyes. You hate all those who do injustice. You destroy those who speak lies, and the Lord loathes the person of bloodshed and deceit." And so we had talked about this a little bit about God's relationship with evil and those that do it, right? And so some of the things that we said was that God has nothing to do with evil, right? And if you notice some of the language that's used there, that God takes no pleasure in wickedness, cannot dwell with him. The boastful will not stand before his eyes. He hates all who do injustice, destroys those who speak lies, loathes the person of bloodshed. Okay, so as David is describing this relationship that God has, or lack thereof, with evil, the words that he's using are very, very strong. It's very strong language. It leaves no ambiguity at whatsoever as to how God views this, right? So David is setting something up here. He's showing us what God thinks of evil, right? Because he's getting ready to contrast that. Okay? So that leads us into really what's our first question tonight is, how does David distinguish himself from evil men? Right? Because you saw what God thinks of evil men, and it's not a good thing. Okay? And so David doesn't want to be like that. Right? So let's look at verses 7 and 8. It says, "But as for me, by your abundant graciousness, I will enter your house. At your holy temple, I will bow in reverence for you. Lord, lead me in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before me." So, how is David going to distinguish himself from these evil men? How is he different? Looking at verses 7 and 8, how is David different? Yeah, he's following God's will, worshiping God. Any other answers? Yeah, I think that that's right. So after David has just gotten done reflecting on God's character, now David's saying what he will do. He says, this is how God views evil. And now he's saying, this is how I'm gonna be. And he says what he's gonna do. He says he's gonna enter God's house by God's abundant graciousness. So dwelling in God's house, having a close relationship with God, right? Not only dwelling near God, but he says he will bow in reverence at God's holy temple. Okay, so when he's here, he's bowing. What does bowing indicate? If you bow to a king or you bow to a dignitary, what are you indicating? You're being humble. It's a sign of respect. Sometimes it can be a sign of loyalty, right? So you are being submissive and respectful to them, right? And so he's doing the same thing. And then it says in reverence. So he's bowing in reverence of God. He's revering God. He's showing reverence to God. So David is telling us action that he's going to take. It's not just that this dwells in his heart. Matt? A little bit different, but a very similar idea there. Worship, right? And I mean, God is the only one worthy of that sort of action. So David is doing all these things to worship God, showing him reverence, being humble in his presence. And these are all actions. And that's what I really want to emphasize here is that these aren't just feelings that David feels and thinks, wow, that's so nice. I think well of God, and now I'm going to go on my way. You know, he's doing something with that. It's action, right? Our faith requires action as well. We can't just say we believe in God and then live however we want. We need to act on that, right? And so David is acting upon these things. And then in verse 8, David prays to be led by God in righteousness. And once again, he offers submission and he asks God to lead him. He says, make your way straight before me, right? And he's asking this, he's asking God to do this to guide him. So again, David's prayer is well thought out, I guess is what I'm saying. He's asking for all the right things, right? He wants God to lead him. He wants God to direct his steps. He's not trusting human wisdom, his own wisdom here, which, you know, again, David is a king. He could certainly get a big head about that and say, well, you know, I lead a country. Certainly I can lead myself. You know, he's asking for God to guide him here. So a lot of good things that David is showing in his character to distinguish himself as being different from the evil men that he just talked about. And then he's asking God to lead him because of his enemies, right? And when I read through this psalm, the sense that I got personally was that this prayer wasn't so much about enemies on a battlefield, so much as it was more about those who sought to ruin David through deceit, through schemes. And it sounds like David needed help navigating those dangerous obstacles. So I don't know if you felt differently. Certainly David had enemies that meant him physical harm in war and battle, but the impression that I got as I read through this was that this was more about the schemers that existed seeking his downfall. Any thoughts there?
Well, you can be very right, because there were many people always scheming to do David wrong.
Yeah, and I mean, even later in his life, we see him attacked by those different schemes, and that's just kind of the impression I got as we were going through here. When you're praying for your way to be made straight, you know, any time that I've prayed for that, it's because I'm uncertain and I don't know what I need to do. Right? Obviously, you can read through the Bible and you know what's right and wrong, but then there's sometimes where maybe you don't have the wisdom to apply that properly, or you're doubting yourself. You know, so I felt like maybe that's a little bit more of what he's seeking. Now, in verse 9, how does David describe these enemies he's facing? How does he describe them? The verse reads, for there is nothing trustworthy in their mouth. Their inward part is destruction itself. Their throat is an open grave. They flatter with their tongue. So if you were to paraphrase that, what are these enemies like?
They're funny bunnies to your face before and behind your back.
Yeah, they're snakes, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're. Look at some of the ways that he describes them. He talks about, in verse 10, he talks about their schemes. These schemers, they're untrustworthy. They have destruction in their inward part. The way I understand that to mean is that internally they seek David's destruction, whereas that might not present on the outward part, right? Having a throat like an open grave, what might that mean? A throat like an open grave. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I mean, the imagery of a grave is that, you know, it's unclean, right? And we have to remember that this is taking place in the Old Testament, so that had a different weight to it than maybe what we think of today. And then the flattering with their tongue. And so again, when you take this together with the rest of the psalm, it's why I think that David is asking for help against the hidden enemies more so than the ones that he can see and fight openly. So this next part is interesting. In verse 10, it says, "Make them pay, God. Have them fall by their own schemes. Scatter them in the multitude of their wrongdoings, for they are rebellious against you." So David asks God to let them fall. And what I want to know is, how do we reconcile that verse with a verse like Matthew chapter 5 and verses 43 to 44? Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 to 44 reads, "You have heard it said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." Okay? So now David is often used as a Christ-like figure, right? He's often used that way in the Old Testament. But here in Matthew, we have Jesus speaking and telling us to love our enemies. But David is saying, let them fall, God, make them pay. So how do we connect that? How do we reconcile that? I think, Judy, you had your hand up first.
Well, that was that's Old Testament.
Uh-huh.
And in Matthew, we have the New Testament. Mm-hmm. So we have a little bit of difference there.
That's true. So we do have that, right? And Jesus references that. He says, you have heard it was said, right? So David's kind of going under a little bit of the old wisdom, where Jesus is showing us a better way, right? Donna, you had your hand up as well.
I think it's because it isn't about David being hurt. It's because they're rebelling against God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are rebelling against God, right? And so that's an issue there too. One of the reasons I point this out so that we can connect these two things is because many times, opponents of the Bible will take things out of context, right? Or they'll try and find a supposed conflict between two verses, right, without taking in the entirety of what's happening. Matt?
One thing I think holds true through the Psalms is that David isn't wanting to bring the vengeance upon his own self to do it, like God let me kill them, or I'm going to kill them, or something. You know, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And so in keeping with that, David's asking God to bring his judgment. And that seems to be consistent as I've studied the Psalms. And I think there's a fancy name for this. It's called an imprecatory psalm. It's where you're praying for God to bring judgment on your
life. Yeah. And that's an excellent point. And so I'm glad you mentioned that, because that theme that Matt mentioned is going to emerge a little bit more in some of the following psalms. So what he was saying was that David isn't asking to get revenge himself. He's not saying, like, God, give me the strength to go out and punish these people. He's simply asking for God's justice to be done. God, let your justice be enacted, right? And we'll see that emerge more and more throughout those psalms. Now, that is okay, right? Because God can mete out justice, right? Not only is that his right, but he can do it fairly in a way that humans never could, right? We know that God is a fair and just and righteous judge. So God is able to do that in a way that humans or no human could ever do, right? Donna, do you have your hand up again?
That's what I was saying, what Matt said.
Mm-hmm.
David wasn't praying for himself to be.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So basically, what I don't want us to walk away with is thinking that, you know, oh, David prayed for his enemies to fall. Hey, that's cool. We can pray for our enemies to just, you know, we can pray for God's justice to be enacted, but it's not, hey, God, let me get revenge on someone because they were mean to me, right? Matt?
Thinking about a New Testament example, actually in Revelation, to tie our classes together.
Yeah.
Revelation 6. 10, and this is where those, I think it's those who had been slain, you know, Christians who had been slain, it says, and they cried out with a loud voice saying, how long, O Master, holy and true, will you not judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? And of course, the whole book is about how God's judgment is brought on them.
Yeah, and see that, That is, and again, I'm glad you brought that one up, because I do think that sometimes Christians get confused as to what's actually being said here. They hear revenge or vengeance or whatever, and it lends itself to maybe the attitude that it's okay for us to seek that when it's not, right? Praying for God to mete out justice is fine. God says that he is a God of justice. And justice will ultimately happen. We can read how in the New Testament that the fact that judgment day hasn't come yet is all for us, right? It's for our benefit, because we're lucky that God is patient and long-suffering, because he's giving us multiple opportunities, a long amount of time for us to make ourselves right, right? All that extra time, you could say, that we're getting is for us to make our way straight, for more of us to go out and spread the word, for more of us to be brought to Christ. It's buying more of us time to get right versus swinging the hammer down right away, right? Ultimately, justice is still going to happen, but we're getting a bit of a reprieve here, a chance to obey. And so that's to our benefit. But God is ultimately a God of justice as well. A couple other points that I want to make in verse 10 is that David was obedient to the law, right? So Old Testament, we talked about that a little bit. While we're under the law of the Spirit, right? So to Judy's point, we are under a more perfect path, right? So just a few key points there. Now, in verses 11 to 12, David gives some advice to those who take refuge in God. And what is it? So verse 11 and 12, the last two verses of this psalm, it says, "But rejoice, all you, or all who take refuge in you. Sing for joy forever, and you may shelter them, that those who love your name may rejoice in you. For you bless the righteous person, Lord. You surround him with favor as with a shield." And so if you are a person who is taking refuge in God, David has some advice for you. And so what is it? What does David tell you to do?
Rejoice.
And why? Why do we rejoice?
Because God is taking care of us.
God's taking care of us, yeah. He's surrounding us with favor as a shield, right? That's a wonderful thing. And you notice how that verse ends there. Those two verses. It talks about those who take refuge in him, and how he blesses them. And remember the first two psalms that we read. The word bless was a key word, right? And so was the idea of taking refuge. And so just a brief summary here of what we talked about here, and then also Sunday morning. So David, in this psalm, he faces many scheming enemies, right? And so he's starting out the day. Remember, he's making this prayer in the morning. And he sets the tone for his day by praying to God. He praises God. He prays for guidance. He prays for God's justice. And then he rejoices. And so this kind of follows that pattern that we talked about, all of David's Psalms having that similar pattern. So any other thoughts on Psalm 5 before we jump into the next two? Okay. So let me just switch over presentations here. Okay, and I'm actually going to turn the fans on. It's kind of warm.
Thank you.
It's a little hot under this light. Is that good? Is that too high? Okay. All right, Psalm 6. And again, I'll be using the NASB is my particular translation here. So one of my favorite Psalms questions, who wrote Psalm 6? David, right? Yeah, you guys are getting way too good at this. So this one, of course, was written by David. This one was neat. So this one, in that first verse, it says that it's to be accompanied on a particular instrument, an instrument called a neginoth. And so, depending on what Bible translation you're following, that'll translate it as an eight-stringed harp or a lyre, okay? And so, if you're wondering what I'm talking about, it's that little instrument over there. You know, you picture like the little stereotypical image of a cherub with a little harp, and that's what it is. So it's just, it's a U shape, and it's got eight strings down the middle that you would play.
Okay. Eight strings, you can hardly see.
I know it's if I made it bigger, there wouldn't be enough room for the words.
Well, I'm glad you said that there's eight strings.
Yeah, it's just got.
Yeah, I see them.
Yeah, right down there. So.
Like a harp.
Yep. So, the Hebrew word there is neginoth, but we would call that a harp or a lyre, depending on. On where you're from, so.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Isn't that what David was to play?
For Saul?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I think so. I don't know if it's the same Hebrew word.
I think that's what he was brought to.
Yeah. I'd have to go back and look that up. I don't know what the Hebrew word is there, if it's the exact same thing or slightly different. But that's a good question. So yeah, so verse 1 says, for the music director, with stringed instruments, upon an eight-string lyre, a psalm of David. Okay, so this is one that's obviously accompanied to music. And so what is David praying for in this psalm? So the second half of verse 1 says, Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger, nor discipline me in your wrath. So what is David praying for in this psalm? This is a little bit different than our previous David psalms.
Praying for forgiveness,
right? So this is a little bit different. Yeah.
Well, he's praying for mercy.
Mercy, yeah. So he said, David is asking for God to forego his rebuke or his discipline, right? Do not rebuke me in your anger. And now, a lot of times we can connect whatever's happening into the psalm to maybe something that's happening in Chronicles or in Samuel. But in this one, we don't have a specific event that we can connect this to. Matt?
Maybe it's because we just read through Job, but I'm thinking it's sort of like how Job was suffering and then calling out to God. That wasn't that Job was guilty of any sin, but he's still, you know, suffering.
Yeah, and that could be too. The way I read about it was that David is worried about being punished due to God's anger, right? That seems to be what's weighing on his mind. Now, what I was wondering is if you turn over to Hebrews really quick. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 7. It says, it is for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? And so we see in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 7, that God chastens those that he loves, those that he cares about. So why might David be worried about God's wrath by being rebuked or chastened here? If God chastens out of love, why does David seem to be so concerned here? Matt?
Well, my mind goes to that occasion where he had taken a census when he ought not to have. And
yeah.
He was given the choices of which punishment to have. He chose God's punishment instead of some foreign nations, but still, it was harsh. And he, you know.
Yeah. Even if God is doing this out of love, it's probably not going to be pleasant to endure, right? And David has some previous experience with that. And so I think all of us can understand that when we know that we've done something wrong and that there is a punishment coming from that as a consequence, you know, none of us are looking forward to that, right? It's not something that you want to do. And you might plead your case and be, I know I messed up. Can we just skip the punishment? I'm enduring enough as it is. I know I did wrong, right? So it seems to be that that is what David is looking for here, is either God's mercy to either skip that punishment or perhaps reduce it some. David's clearly aware that he's done something, that he's stepped out of line. Yeah.
Actually, we are not any different than David, because we are always praying for the forgiveness of our sins and
yeah.
our doings.
Mm-hmm.
If not, then there's something wrong, because we all sin.
Right. Yeah, we all mess up.
We
this
know
is Yeah.
I'm sure that everyone in here will be praying for the
Yeah, until I've passed through my turn and I know I've made it through the gates, that I'm going to be maybe just a little bit nervous, right? Yeah.
Even though God says.
Yeah. Well, and it's
human thing that you're not sure if you're going
to
make it.
Yeah, and I think a lot of that too is since we're talking about Job, going back to Job. Job was a very righteous man, and in the presence of God, you know, very fearful and trembling. Like, you can't help but be that way in God's presence, being an imperfect creature in the presence of perfection, you know, so you're going to feel that. Now, David here, he doesn't just say, God, have mercy on me. He actually gives some grounds. He tries to build a case for why God might be merciful to him. In verses 2 and 3, he says, "Be gracious to me, Lord, for I am frail. Heal me, Lord, for my bones are horrified, and my soul is greatly horrified. But you, Lord, how long?" And so on what grounds is David pleading for mercy? What's he base his case off of? Why should God be merciful to him?
Because
he's weak, right? He's weak. He's frail, he says.
And yes, he's weak, and he's human.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and he says, he asks for mercy because he's weak. And he says that he's suffering from two types of trouble. Two types of trouble. What are they?
His soul.
His soul? Okay.
And his bones.
Right, so his soul is spiritual, right? And your bones,
physically
and spiritually suffering. And so in your Bible, mine says greatly horrified, yours might say vexed or troubled.
Sore
vexed. He's bothered completely, right? Spiritually he's bothered, physically he's bothered. This is just completely upsetting to him. Right? This is a big deal for David. He's really upset by this. Now, at the end of verse 3, David, he asks God, he says, how long? How long what? What does he mean there? What is he asking? Matt?
I think it goes with the next verse where he's asking for rescue from God. It's almost like that verse of Revelation. How long until you'll come and bring vengeance upon?
Yeah. So how long before he's saved? Or to look at it from the slightly different angle, how long do I have to endure the punishment, right? How long will that be? How long till I'm saved? How long will this be? And so just as he made a case for mercy, David also makes a case for his deliverance here. In verses 4 to 5, David says, starting in verse 4, he says, "Return, Lord, rescue my soul. Save me because of your mercy. For there is no mention of you in death. In Sheol, who will praise you?" So David's making a case for deliverance. What is it? Why should God save him? What's that?
Let me live.
Let me live. Okay. Any other thoughts? Donna?
Let him live, because if he doesn't live, no one's going to
Yeah. I think that it shouldn't be comical, but it feels slightly comical that David's like, well, if I'm dead, who's going to be praising you on earth, right? You know? So it's interesting, but so David's making a case for his deliverance based off, first of all, God's mercy, first and foremost. Not David's own merits, right? Not, I'm a great and wonderful king and I've done so many awesome things. He's saying, no, save me, deliver me because you are merciful. So he's appealing to God's character. But also from a practical standpoint, David's saying, look, I can't serve you in Sheol. I can't serve you from the grave. I can't be here praising you, inspiring others to praise you. He can't be doing those things. Now, again, since this is a theme for tonight, going back to Job, when we were in Job, we saw that Old Testament understanding of the afterlife was a little murky, right? They didn't quite have the same understanding as the afterlife that we did. And that's because Jesus brought to light much of what we know about the afterlife. So turn over to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 10. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 10 says, but has now been revealed by the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. There's a lot about our afterlife that Jesus revealed, whether through his teaching or later, like in Revelation. There's a lot that was revealed about the afterlife and the symbolism that goes with it, what it might look like, how it might function. All of those things was revealed later. But in David's time, they didn't have the New Testament, right? They didn't have all those books. They had what they had, and that was it. And so their understanding of the way that things operated was a little bit different. And so we can understand that David wasn't exactly sure how things worked in the afterlife. Now, we might say, well, David, you know, we know that there are living creatures that sing praises to God day and night in the afterlife. So, yeah, I think you could praise God in the afterlife. What are you talking about? But he didn't know that, right? A lot of those writings were later, long after David had lived. And so David didn't have those things to go off of. So we can understand why he would say that. But ultimately, David is simply making the case that he can serve God more if he's alive, right? That's kind of what he's basing his case off of here. Any thoughts, comments, or questions? Shirley beat you to it.
Yes, in Psalms 51.
Psalms 51, yep.
And that is about, this was a psalm after David had went into Bathsheba.
Uh-huh.
And in verse 7 it says, purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins. Blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. And I think of those verses quite often.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
yeah. David, it's easy.
It does.
And it's easy to see why David was called a friend of God, why he had such a good attitude. Because even when David sinned, when you look at the way that David was repenting and the attitude that he had of repentance and his humility, David was always accepting of his punishments. He always understood that, you know, I've stepped out of line. I sinned. I need to fix this. It was never, oh, God's being way too harsh on me. It was always, I need to get right. And so that another great example of that attitude.
Well, it's kind of like a prayer for, it's a prayer so that he can go on with his life.
Yeah. Matt, did you also have your hand up?
I was going to say, another reason maybe that he's appealing. I mean, he's appealing is to God's loving kindness. He says, save me, in verse 4, save me because of your loving kindness. He's like appealing. Because you're so great.
Right.
you would be inclined to save
me. Yeah. Just like when he was talking about his mercy, just a verse or two further up. Yeah. Save me because of your loving kindness, because of your mercy, because of your righteousness. Right? Appealing to God's character rather than David's own merits. Don?
David knew that there was nothing he could do or say. Only God could save him.
Right, exactly. And so where I want to leave off tonight is basically the good points that we've seen thus far in that psalm of how we might want to appeal to God maybe when we mess up next time. Because certainly that's going to happen, right? And so understanding the way that David appealed, and David had a lot of good points in his psalm, maybe there's something in there that you can incorporate into your own prayers, either the words or the idea behind that, that will help you out. So keep that in mind. We'll continue this Sunday morning because Rick will still be out of town, so we'll finish through this psalm Sunday morning. Thank you, everyone.
I would take a moment and look at the end of 2 Timothy, or the end of 1 Timothy, right before 2 Timothy. 1 Timothy 6, starting in verse 17. Some of the parting, concluding comments that Paul writing to Timothy here. He says, in verse 17, command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty or to set their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. Command them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed. And it's easy to look at that and say, well, okay, so Timothy's supposed to talk to the rich people and tell them this, and that's them and not us. I think if we take a step back and think about our perspective as Americans, generally we have a very nice building we're meeting in. We have many changes of clothes we're able to wear. We have cars we're able to drive here. And there's a lot of ways in which, relatively speaking, we're quite wealthy compared to a lot of people in the world and compared to people in the first century a lot of times. And there's blessings we can do. So we should probably think about this in terms of ourselves, not to make ourselves haughty thinking we're rich. That's the whole point. We shouldn't be haughty. But command those who are rich in this present age, those of us who have a little more than we need, or maybe a lot more than we need, we should not be haughty. We should not be arrogant and puffed up and like, whoa, I've got all this stuff. And be looked down on anybody that maybe has less. And we shouldn't set our hope on the uncertainty of riches. You know, it's easy to look at maybe our retirement plan or something, or the house that we've built and put a lot of effort in over the years, or whatever, some material thing, we think, well, it's really going to last. I built that well, or I bought a good one, or whatever it is. Those things are all fleeting. Our cars are going to rust. Our houses are going to burn down. Our money is going to inflate and be worth nothing. You know, eventually we're all going to pass away. We shouldn't be haughty and arrogant, and we shouldn't set our hope on the uncertainty of riches, because those things are not going to be established. But instead, we should set our hope on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. And so there's that word rich again, but richly. Not about those riches and things, but on those spiritual blessings we have in Christ. That's where we should put our hope and our trust. And again, he says to command them to do good and to be rich. There's that rich again. To be rich in good works, right? Not to worry about that physical stuff, but to be kind to one another and to share those things. It even says to be generous and ready to share. To not get caught up in whatever things we have and have some sort of pride in that. But instead, put our effort and our our love and our energy into sharing and blessing others with those things. And it says in verse 19, sort of the result of having that attitude, that correct attitude of being kind and sharing and good works and sharing with others, that we're storing up for themselves, or we're storing up for ourselves, the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed. So, you know, one phrase in our culture was, you know, the good life. You know, I'm on my porch with my iced tea and my beautiful tree, or whatever, you know, this nice scene or something, something pleasant that we would like. This is the good life. And that's nice. We should certainly be thankful for those moments that we can enjoy nice weather and all of those sorts of things. But rather than that life, those physical things, we should be looking forward to life indeed, eternal life in Christ Jesus, and focusing on God's will and having all of those attitudes that we should have, being humble and being generous and sharing. He goes on to say, O Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to you, turning aside from godless and empty chatter and the opposing arguments of what is falsely called knowledge. I think a reference perhaps to Gnosticism or something there, some false teaching that was going on, which some, while professing, have gone astray from the faith. Grace be with you. So some good parting comments for Timothy there in that letter, but also some good things for us to think about. We should be full of love for one another, full of kindness, and having that right attitude about setting our mind on spiritual things, not on physical things, having eternal life being our goal and not stuff. And so the song I want to sing here kind of goes with that, how sweet, how heavenly, number 219. It's this idea of how blessed it is to be able to be kind to one another and to have empathy and sympathy for one another and different things. So a little bit of a different invitation, I guess. We want to encourage us to have that right attitude, but certainly if there's anyone that needs to obey the gospel, we want to help you with that tonight, but we want to encourage you to always and ever be growing in your changing, transforming your mind towards God's will instead of our own. So if anyone could be, wants any help with any of those things tonight, we encourage you to come, if you will, as we stand and sing this song together, 219.